Hello and welcome to On Point. I'm Morgan Ball. Most millennials are getting their news online and often through mobile devices. So some experts worry that it's easier for young people to be manipulated. A 2017 Pew Research study says 67% of all Americans get their news from social media like Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, and Snapchat. Nearly two-thirds of adults say fabricated news stories on social media may cause confusion and a lack of trust about the basic facts of current issues and events. Which poses the question, are students media literate enough to avoid manipulation by fake news? The U.S. and Canada have named this week Media Literacy Week, and at CSUN, students are taught media literacy is the ability to analyze, evaluate and create, reflect on, and act out the many messages communicated across all media platforms. Some CSUN students say they agree media literacy is important.
Media literacy is basically just being able to interpret and understand and critically analyze every news in any form of, I guess, media. It's extremely important because if you think about it, like, little kids should be learning about this. Like, they're nowadays, like, little kids are constantly taking in so much of the media. You know, they're like constantly in electronics. They're constantly heavily involved in it. So they should be able to interpret that, and they should be able to understand that, hey, this might not be right, or just question things. You know, I feel like it's very easy to be persuaded to think a certain way, and it's important we question what kind of information is coming our way, especially little kids, because they're so impressionable.
Because I think it's our job as citizens to be informed and to find the truth, and not, and we all have biases, but we should more try to say, like, the scientific method. Try to prove it wrong, and if it's not, and if you can't prove it wrong, that means it's true.
Because without it, we're kind of being constantly attacked by misinformation, and if we don't understand the difference between what's real and what's fake that's coming across our news feeds, then we inherently just take on a bunch of perspectives that we don't actually know exist, or if they're justifiable or whatnot.
Media literacy experts say digital media and news literacy lead to civic engagement and ultimately to what they call digital citizenship. For students to become digital citizens, they must know the details of the First Amendment and the role and responsibility of the press in a democracy. Media literacy experts ask students to question who created the messages they get and what techniques are used to attract the reader's attention, why the message is being sent, and what the purpose is. On Point's Minerva Medrano has more on the story.
Thank you, Morgan. I'd like to thank our guests for being here today. We have Anya Crittenton, a graduate student. We have Cinema Television Arts Professor Anna Marie Pierce-Simoni, and Chair of CSUN Political Science Department, Dr. David Leach. Thank you all for joining us. I'd like to begin with a question for all three of you, but we're going to begin with you, Anya. In social media news, there's a loss of complexity in the way that news is presented. Can you tell me why do you think that is, and what is the impact of that?
Yeah, I think social media, what it's done is it's offered a platform for a lot more voices than we used to have. And so it's easy to, A, get lost in the shuffle of it all, but also, you know, it's easier for false stories to get out there and get amplified by how many more opportunities they have and how fast the internet moves. It's really easy to lose track of stories. So while there are some upsides to the internet and social media, you know, getting more diverse voices out there, it's also a lot easier to lose sight of being critical and analytical because everything happens so fast and it's hard to kind of judge things.
I actually don't think that it takes away from the complexity. I think it adds to it in some ways. That is part of what makes it so confusing. We've gone on ever since the dawn of small format video and film, media's become more democratic. So we went from the voice of authority, the gatekeepers of maybe three networks, to the voice of many. And now it's ping-ponging or ricocheting from the many to the many. That gets confusing, but we also can research many more sources of content on a topic than we might have had access to before.
Would you like to add as well?
Sure. I mean, in some ways, I think I agree with both my fellow panelists' point. I think that one of the features of the democratization of the media has been that the it's not obvious that the attention space that's available has expanded at the same rate as the number of voices. And so there's an awkward competition for scarce attention space, which provides some obvious incentives to sort of ramp up rhetoric and to cleave out the complexities that may not sort of grab a reader's attention right away. And that's one of what might be an unfortunate downside of this democratization.
Right. It's the cacophony of democratization.
Yes.
Yeah.
They're all interesting points. Well, would any of you like to elaborate on what exactly fake news is?
Mm. you know, I think it's putting false narratives out into the ether, especially with a point. I mean, fake news is intended to harm. It's intended to mislead. It's not typically done just for fun, especially with political fake news. You know, it's intended to get reactions and intended to sway voters or kind of the political pendulum, as it were. We saw a lot of that in the election last year. And so I think that's what it is you have to be careful, because it's not just some prank story all the time. It can absolutely hurt democracy and, you know, people as citizens, as voters with a voice.
I think there's been fake news around for a long time. We just have more of it because we have more of everything and more voices doing that. But from the early days of yellow journalism, the building of the Hearst Empire to the building of the Murdoch Empire, there's been fake journalism. National Enquirers, The Globe, things that would grab attention on a grocery line, the way clickbait titles have everybody jumping from one article to another without taking the time to really evaluate it. Things get shared, they get amplified and ramped up. And I think, and then there's an intentionality to it. The fake news, for example, right now the claims of Russian, you know, infiltrating our election and posting things, ads and news, was done actually during the time of the civil rights era as well, before the internet.
Yeah. I mean, I think it dates back even further than you're identifying. By the time you see Jefferson running for the presidency, right, you have op research. You have doggerels being written about accusations of infidelity. You have, I mean, right, there are court cases about, from 1801, 1802, about these sorts of lies. I mean, we should be candid and call them lies in the media. And so what I think, to the extent that there's something different about fake news, it's our own awareness of them. This is maybe what the upsides of the democratization, mm-hmm, is, that while this has been going on through the entire history of the U.S. at least, and probably well previous to that, my sense is that there is a greater awareness of this as a feature and a greater critical sense that this is a thing that ought to be addressed.
And Professor Pierce-Simone, do you believe technology is the only factor and spreading fake news today?
No, as Professor Leach pointed out earlier. Sorry about that.
Oh.
You know, this was happening very early on. We've seen it through different political cycles, but technology absolutely is ramping it up, making it more possible, and giving the reins over to more people who can do that. That cannot necessarily be constrained. It took a while. It wasn't really until about the early 1900s that journalism really started developing a code of ethics. You know, a lot of it was sponsored material. Most newspapers were there to fill in content, to carry advertising, as was television. It's the soap operas were created to sell soap. So I think that's a bit of that. We're in a period like that now.
As you mentioned before, fake news isn't new, but it has become such a huge issue in today's media. Why do you think that is?
Well, I think it's because it is amplified. People are noticing it. More people are doing it. And they are getting a kind of literacy for it. So we have literacy. You know, we can read and write. And you need to read to be able to write, really. They're intertwined. Media literacy is one thing that's been around since around the 60s. Especially concerned with children's viewing of television, to read advertising and know when they're being, you know, persuaded in a certain way. I worked at the American Film Institute, where we developed a K-12 screen education program that was dealing with screen literacy, more to understand the language, the nomenclature, and the structure of cinema. They are not separate. AFI kept it sort of separate, but they're really intertwined. And the more people that are understanding, they know how to point a camera, they know how to cut, they know how to do things, they know how to Photoshop. Speaking of fake things, so we're going to see more and more of that happening, I think.
Dr. Leach, how heavily do you think fake news contributed to the outcome of the presidential election?
This is the subject of some scholarly debate. How much do they contribute? I think I'm going to actually answer a question that's slightly different than the one you asked, which is how much did it contribute uniquely to this election? Because there's no question that there's been fake news sort of throughout U.S. elections, and that there's been some effect. The early studies that I am aware of suggest that there was a meaningful impact of these sorts of fake news stories that were especially targeted in sort of the battleground states, especially along the blue wall, that the Clinton campaign had clearly thought was going to provide a buttress against sort of larger losses in the South and West. So I should say, like, these are very early studies, and the way science proceeds, there's constant revision. But the early studies of which I'm aware suggest that there was a meaningful impact.
And Professor Pierce-Simone, how did President Trump's tweets contribute to fake news?
Well, a personal opinion is that a lot of the tweets were fake news themselves, therefore opening the door to others. I mean, someone in that position is in somewhat of a role model position. But I think more than anything, what concerns me more than the fake news are these idea of these filter bubbles, particularly brought out by Eli Pariser, who has his own filter bubble, and very admittedly, he's, you know, a little more left of center. He was one of the founders of Move On. And we all walk around with our filter bubbles without the aid of technology, our analog filter bubbles. We choose by the neighborhood we choose, the schools we go to, our hobbies, who we're hanging out with, that we're sort of separating what information we want to hear. But we still have more opportunities to run into people with different views. As things are happening on the internet, we choose that too. Who we're connecting with, who our friends are, what we're watching. But now those powers, those technologies, are using algorithms to tell us who we are and serve us what they think they've gleaned that we want to see, and sometimes narrowing what we're doing. So we have our fake news, some other people have their fake news, and never the twain shall meet if it keeps going the way it's going.
Well, still on the topic of fake news, Dr. Leach, President Trump recently spoke to Fox Business Network's Lou Dobbs and bragged about coming up with the term fake news and how he convinced people of how fake it is. But now there are experts saying that the press should stop using the term altogether. Do you agree with that this is something that should be done, and what would be the consequences of that?
Yeah, I mean, at least for myself, I don't think there's a lot of value added to the concept of fake news. I mean, we already have a perfectly rich conceptual vocabulary: lies, falsehoods, untruths, propaganda. And I understand that sort of, you know, Trump, let's say, popularized the term fake news, which was then very, very, very quickly picked up by his political opponents in order to suggest that it was Trump himself who was creating fake news, and that this was sort of an attempt at a kind of rhetorical jujitsu to use the strength against him. But I just don't think that it's obviously a winning tactic. I mean, we have ways of talking about this already. I think that the use of the term fake news robs us of the richness of talking about very precise different forms of falsehoods, very different attempts to deceive, exactly how they're operating. And that sort of flattening, I think, is problematic.
And Anya, fake news is described as a symptom of a lack of media literacy, yet Pew Research shows that 8 in 10 adults get their news from a mobile device. So how are adults still lacking media literacy, yet all the time spent on their mobile devices?
I think mobile devices inherently don't, you know, make it worse. I'm a proponent of mobile devices myself. I think one of the problems is that the internet has made humans have a shorter attention span. And so we are quicker to scroll through things. There's so much more on a mobile device now, and you can just scroll through, you read a headline, and that's it. And that's all you do. No critical thinking, no analysis. You read something, someone's shared it, and you just sort of make a snap judgment. And I think that's also a danger. And instead of, you know, like you were saying with film, there are cues in certain things in film, in literature, in journalism. There are cues that you can pick up on when you become media literate to kind of suss out the whether or not it's fake news and how legitimate it is. And so I think it's less about the mobile devices themselves and just kind of the way it's changed our culture and how quick we move and how quick we read things. And I think it's damaging to journalism itself. While people are now, you know, ready to believe fake news, there's also this increasing cynicism and distrust of the media. And I think that is also dangerous, since the media inherently is meant to be for the people. And if we turn our back on them, that's also dangerous. But call me an idealist, so.
Would you like to call you that, happily.
I am.
Would you like to add to that, Professor Pearson?
Yeah, I agree with, you know, just everything that you were saying there. I think what we have to figure out now is how that works with the technology companies. I think Lindsey Graham was saying how, you know, worried he was about, no, it was Kennedy, sorry, Senator Kennedy, who said he was worried about how powerful they were. And it's because of this algorithmic power that they have. It's also because of how intertwined they are in all of our lives. Everything is now run on mobile devices or others. It's digital. And how should they be gatekeepers or not? What's, you know, that's the big question. What's their responsibility? What's, are they content providers? Are they editors? Are they just what, as cable operators used to say, oh, don't blame us, safe harbor, we're just the messenger. It's not our content. And YouTube still functions that way. Content providers, copyright holders have to give a thumbs down if something's violated. So this idea of who's running the show and the ship, guiding it, we have to figure out what responsibility they have, but not give them too much gatekeeping, because even propaganda is considered free speech. So where's the line drawn between agitprop and hate speech? Those are the things that we have to start to redefine for this era.
Would you like to add as well?
I mean, I agree with both my fellow panelists. One thing that I think I would perhaps amplify is your concern about these sorts of companies which are engaged in simultaneous media production, media distribution, sort of algorithmic sorting and advertising, that these companies are doing so many different things that used to be separate that we don't really know what they are. One thing I guess I would just emphasize is that any answer is a risky answer, right? There's no obvious safe answer. There's no risk-free answer. Anything that we say, any way we characterize these, is going to have a set of trade-offs. There are going to be benefits and drawbacks for any of these. And so the sort of ongoing conversation about how to regulate, how to understand, how to conceptualize these, we shouldn't think that this is a conversation where we will all come to an easy, obvious answer, but rather it's going to be informed by different risk preferences, different positions in sort of a power-laden social space, that the answers that people, reasonable people, are going to give very different answers, and that we should be prepared for that in this conversation.
Yeah. There's always an ebb and flow in terms of concentration of media.
Yeah.
Cross-ownership's been a problem for a long time. General Electric owned everything from TV stations, the satellite dishes, programming content suppliers, and the refrigerator when you got up to make a snack in the middle of a show. You know, so that happens. And then suddenly from the fringes, more, especially as new technology is made available, that's where the public really comes in more. I mean, the fax machine is what helped in Tiananmen Square. Made a big difference. The big media companies, the TV stations, weren't even paying attention to what the students were doing, you know, by being able to use the fax machine. The Arab Spring, because of social media and YouTube. And that's coming from outside. But as it seeps in to mainstream media and companies start to buy each other up and the big fish are eating the little fish, we get back to that same cycle of where's that concentration of ownership and power, and who owns the tech companies.
Interesting point. And this one goes for everyone. When trying to deconstruct fake news, why is it important to check our own biases?
I think, like you were saying, the filter bubble, that has become far more prevalent you know, it's always been there. We've always had our political leanings, but it's become worse and worse, especially with social media. You follow people who have similar ideals to you, and so that's the only news you see, and they share stories and they amplify them. And so while I don't think there is a problem with bias, we all have them, journalists have them, they're part of our human nature, and you know, they help us be democratic citizens with a voice, but I think it's important to try and take a step back and look at the whole picture sometimes rather than just focusing in on the thing that you already believe is true. You're just confirming what you already thought to be true. And so it's important to kind of broaden out while still staying true to your ideals. I think that's still important. But rather than seeking out what you already know, seek out what you don't know.
Would you like to add?
Totally agree with that. And yeah, that's what the filter bubbles kind of point out. I'm a little afraid that it's harder to seek out what you don't know if we do get sort of encapsulated in these bubbles. But I also think that part of media literacy is to understand that as soon as you choose where you're pointing a camera, you're making a political decision, you're showing a bias, and understand what you're being persuaded by when you are consuming media. And those two things kind of go hand in hand with us people are using media more. If you choose a certain camera angle, you're making a statement. It's simple as even as you pick up a pen and start to write, there's a bias that you're bringing to it.
And I think that the awareness of your own biases is the only way that you can start to pierce the bubble. If you don't know, if you don't know what your biases are, if you don't know what your preferences are, if they're sort of unexamined, unaware, unconscious, then you don't have any strategies for confronting them. And I'll be an advocate. I will say it's good to confront your biases, not just because it's sort of healthy and democratic, because it's fun. Because talking with people you always agree with is boring. Reading things that you could have written, like that's, you know, we're only here for 85, 90 years on a good run. And I think there's something bracing and enjoyable about confronting yourself with the alien and traveling and seeing these different things. So I would just be an advocate of this for political reasons, but for hedonistic reasons.
I will say placing objectivity on a pedestal has always struck me as equally dangerous. The media can have a really big problem with false balance.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I believe with certain topics, like with global warming, giving equal weight to both sides of an argument in global warming doesn't actually help the issue and doesn't help people understand global warming because it implies that the idea that it might not be happening is equally weighted to the idea that it definitely is happening. And most of the science community thinks so. And so I think it's also about transparency and being honest rather than just wholly objective, because not every opinion is equal in every story, so.
Right. I've never seen so many people referring to red herrings and false equivalency as I have over the last year in social media. And one of the good things of social media is it has kind of broken that wall of the voice of authority in media and allows, you know, it's more valuable, it's more accepted and trusted, especially by younger generations when they sense that there's some authenticity, and authenticity comes from some self-awareness and questioning.
I think, like we've seen a replacement of sort of the voice of authority, which used to be dominant, with the voice of this balance. And I think clearly we're starting to see the problems with both of these. And now I'm sort of curious, what comes next? Like, what's going to be the value that we move to and valorize? And I don't know.
They're very interesting points. Who are some experts students can turn to when trying to spot fake news?
There's factcheck.org, Snopes, although people claim that Snopes is biased. That's the thing, if you enter into this wall, this hall of mirrors, but to cross-check, the best thing that I tell my students is not only to follow the money, but to follow the breadcrumbs, especially if you go to Wikipedia, down at the bottom of the page, check all those little footnotes, and then double-check them. Cross-referencing is the best thing that you can, and see if you can find the opposite view of what you're looking at, and then, you know, make some, you know, understand that. Pew Center, Poynter, the Electronic Frontiers Foundation are all good sources to understand media and the politics of media.
I mean, Without disagreeing with any of the sources, I would say that what students, what all citizens should be doing is training themselves and not relying on experts. I worry that the sort of a reliance on experts to identify fake news or lies is moving backwards to that time of sort of media consolidation and domination, and that what instead we're sort of experiencing is we have these radically democratized media. It's hard for us to catch up, but it's our responsibility to catch up. I mean, what students need to do, what all of us need to do is to read things more critically, to follow the footnotes, exactly as you were saying, to try and verify, to try and read the original sources. I mean, when you read a media account of a study, go back and read the study. I would be more comfortable recommending places to get training to do it yourself than to recommend clearing houses that were issuing sort of statements about what was real and fake. But that's,
I wish I could remember the full name of this acronym. I was telling it to you. I knew it before I came in here.
I want to say
the CROP test, which we have on our library website, the OVIAT, here at CSUN, but it's credibility, relevance, accuracy. It's forgetting the other two in there, but you can find it on csun.edu/OVIAT. There's multiple library guides.
We have time for one more question, since we're on the topic of it. Since young adults are mainly getting their news from social media, what are some additional steps they should take to deconstruct fake news? You mentioned training, you mentioned the acronym. Is there anything else?
I think there are some things that are easy as, like I mentioned the cues earlier. I took a class on media literacy last semester with Professor Eisenstock here. Mm-hmm. And one of the things we started is there are some like baby steps almost you can take when reading a story is looking for dates and an established author, links, sources, whether or not they're anonymous or named, and just simple things like that. You can even start with those little things, look for those, and then cross-referencing. So I think it's overwhelming, but there are some smaller things you can do step by step to kind of teach yourself and train yourself to get better.
Consider the source is really important today. It's an old adage, that's one of the things that Google and Facebook and Twitter are going to be pushed to do, is to make sure that bylines and dates and things are more prominent. And I, push my students to do that, to always look, where did it come from? Does it look, are you reading an ad for the milk trade industry, or is it a credible outside journalistic source? And the best way still is cross-referencing, get multiple.
That's all the time that we have for today. Thank you all so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching On Point. You can follow us on social media at CSUN On Point. You can watch us on LA 36 on Fridays at 8:30 in the morning and on Santa Clarita Valley Cable TV on Sunday afternoons at 5. And you can listen on KCSN 88.5 every Sunday morning at 5:30. Media Literacy Week is November 6th through the 10th, featuring newspaper salons, a screen and tweet of the documentary The Illusionists, and a Facebook challenge meant to deconstruct images about diversity. For all of us here at On Point, I'm Morgan Ball.